have right now to worship and hear from you, whether it's listening through the worship or listening through the word that Dr. Taylor is going to bring. We pray that we would be ready for what you have to say to us, because we know that you have something in mind. The question is just, are we going to listen? Are we going to look for it? And so I pray this morning that we will be attentive, that we will pay attention to what you want to say to us. Again, whether it's through the songs that we're going to sing or whether it's through the message from Dr. Taylor, just help us to listen. So we thank you for the chance that we have today and just ask for your continued blessing. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Worship group.
pray. Dear Lord, thank you for bringing us here today and just for giving us this opportunity to meet here. Even though we're social distance and we're in masks, God, you've still given us this opportunity to worship you. And just remind us of that. Remind us that it's a blessing, God. Just be with each and every one of us throughout our days and give us an amazing school year. In your name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Man, I couldn't wait to get back into chapel this week when I heard that we were actually going to get to worship. Hey, at the essence of worship, at the center of worship, it's not a space, it's not the light show, it's not the music. At the essence of worship is our heart, right? So our heart. I don't know anything different than what you guys used to have. But I know that the space is a little bit different where we used to be at, and I know that that can be a little bit different. But hey, listen, I just want to encourage you. At the essence of worship is our heart. That's really the most important thing that we can bring to worship. So hey, so our theme this year is be bold. And man, I was excited. You know, everybody kind of, when you begin worship, you're kind of wondering what that is. And man, I saw a couple of folks pop right to their feet. Being bold, and then what's really cool is then you see that follow. In our middle school chapel beforehand, there was kind of a pocket right over here, and went over, man, those guys stood to their feet, and then what they found is that everybody else started standing. It's just that idea of being bold and being willing to really place Christ first in who we are and what we get to do. So, hey, so we are working through this year this theme of Acts, okay? So we're walking through the book of Acts, looking at the theme, be bold, all right? And last week we did D groups, which loving my D group. But the week before that, we did just kind of an overview, kind of skipping through some different ideas in Acts. This week we're going to dig deeper into just chapter 1 and really be able to understand that, okay? But our theme this year, be bold. We're going to cover three basic aspects today. We're going to cover the Holy Spirit, and we're going to dig fairly deep into the Holy Spirit. And then we're also going to cover the Big 12, the 12 disciples, and see how and why they were united. And then we're going to also look at mission control, see what that mission is, see what that mission was supposed to be, and understand how that really does inform our lives. Now, I'm a big one for understanding what video can do, and also just the idea of spoken word. So I love spoken word. Which is like poetry, but it's in video, and it's something that really expresses a kid's heart. So, hey, pay attention here just for a quick minute, and I want you to pay attention to this spoken word.
You are the giver of all perfect gifts. It is so reassuring to hear it. The way it calms my spirit is a testament of how the Spirit was given to me in an act of kindness on a tree, I mean. Isn't it obvious that we can't even be without our King, our Lord, and the Word, the Sword, the Everlasting, the Sovereign One, the Giver of all perfect gifts. He who sits on the throne, He whom we lift, is the one and only God, because there is none beside Him. The greatest treasure in heaven, descending only to die for my sin. Do you get it now? Without this, there is only darkness. We could be lost in a world full of sin, and thus we must understand the gift that our Father God has given us. Through the cross, we have the Holy Spirit living in us. It's alive in us, abides in us. Spirit, be my guide. I must conform to holy ways and praise His name. Through you is how we pray. You make a way for us to worship with words we can't express. We welcome you, so be our guest and intercede for us. Come and speak to all the hearts and all the yearning lives. We know not how we ought to pray, so Spirit, be our guide. Guide us, Holy Spirit, to the path that leads to Him. We want to hear your voice, so come and speak to us again.
All right, so hey, I love that just short poem, that short spoken word that really engages the idea of the Holy Spirit. And man, I love watching young people who get engaged with their faith and really try to challenge what God is going to be, who God is going to be, what God is going to do in their own lives. And the story of this young man is such a cool story. But this young man who did this, just what I love about his story most is he said, hey, when I gave my life to Christ, when I really surrendered my life to Christ, my whole world changed. My outlook on the world, the way that I perceived difficulty, the way that I perceived trouble, the way that I handled challenges, the way that I dealt with relationships, his whole life was altered once he engaged who Christ was, right? And this kid is making a huge impact. He's a singer, he's a poet, and he's making a huge impact on his culture for Christ because he's made the determination to place Christ first. He's made that determination to live a bold life. So in Acts, this is what we see right throughout the book. We're going to see this word bold. We're going to see how bold these men and women were for their faith. We're going to see how they engaged truth. That Jesus disappears here in chapter 1 in the ascension. He goes up into heaven in the clouds. And now these men and women are left. These men and women are left to be able to impact the world. And indeed they do. They impact and change the whole world, because they've made the determination that they will take this mission as their own. So let's pop through a few ideas. Here's just a little piece of background, okay? This is Luke. Luke wrote the book of Acts. This is the second book he wrote. The first book that he wrote was Luke, yes, okay. So Luke wrote Luke, and then Luke wrote Acts. This is the second book. And here's where he is, and just in chapter 1, verses 1 through 3, it says, I have dealt with all that Jesus began to do and teach, until the day when he was taken up, that's the ascension, after he had given commands. Now look at this, though. He gave commands through the Holy Spirit, okay? And that's what we're going to dig into hardcore today. He presented, given through the Holy Spirit, to the apostles whom he had chosen. All right, let me pause there. The 12 apostles, we touched on all 12 of them last week. None of them would have been who people would have picked. Like if we had talked about the stages of leadership, and there's all these different leadership gurus who talk about how to select leadership. Listen, I'm just telling you, if all of these guys took all of those tests, none of them would have been selected, okay? These are unlikely heroes. But here's the great thing, is that they were chosen. And listen, when you've been chosen, when you've surrendered your life to Christ, when you've made that determination that you're going to give over your life to Christ, at that point in time, listen, you can rest secure in the idea that God chose you, and he didn't choose you for mediocrity. He chose you for a specific purpose. He chose you so that you would also engage your world. So, man, listen, I love this morning already. We see this worship team come up here, right? And they are singing their hearts out. Love to see just the passion of Christ that's in them, that's overflowing. That takes courage. That takes courage to be able to do that. A couple of you guys being the first ones who stood. Just, man, I'm not looking around. I don't care what anybody else does. I'm worshiping, you know? Hey, that takes courage. You have to make the determination as to whether you are going to allow God to fill you up, right? And so here we see that these 12, the 12 disciples, but also we're going to see 120 people who are kind of the inception of the church. They're chosen, okay? They're chosen. They're picked by the creator of the universe, the same creator who spoke the planets into orbit, that spoke the world into existence. That same creator has a plan for your life if you'll let him work that out in your world. He presented himself alive to them after his suffering, appearing to them during 40 days. Now, let's kind of dig a little deeper, because in this section of scripture, we see the Holy Spirit being introduced. And we're going to see that throughout this book. So it's important for us to grasp what this is, okay? So here's a section in chapter 1, and let me just kind of hit the highlights here. While staying with them, he ordered them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father. Now, here's something cool, and this is something that's important to know, is that we can look through Scripture and see that even Jesus' mission was not a mission that he chose. It was a mission that he was directed by the Father. We could go to John chapter 5 and verse 19, where it says that he does nothing except for what the Father directs him to do. So here we see that same theology being applied. So we've got the Father. We've got Jesus, who's on mission. Now he's being ascended, right? His mission was on earth to bring truth. And now we have the Holy Spirit being introduced. We have this Trinity being introduced. So he says, wait for the promise of the Father. Now, John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. Now, all of these dudes are scratching their head because they don't exactly know what that means. Now, in the Old Testament, we can see several references to the Holy Spirit. We can see several references of the Trinity. But we know that the disciples kind of missed the purpose of Jesus even while he's with them. In the same section of scripture, remember, just before Jesus ascends into heaven, they still ask him the question like, okay, so Lord, now we're going to take over and become a political force? Like, they're still even confused. And frankly, that always makes me feel better. But here he says, hey, you'll be baptized with the Holy Spirit. Now, here's the cool thing. It says, you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. Now, here is the thing that absolutely should give us energy, that should give us vigor, that should allow us to understand how powerful this is. Here, Jesus is talking to these 12 disciples. And he's saying, hey, when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, you're going to have this power. But here's the cool thing. That same commandment, that same promise, that same edict is for us as well. If you know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, you claim this same power. You claim this same power as your own. Therefore, you can endure life. You can challenge life. I had a privilege to be chatting with our seniors at the senior convocation at the end of last week. And I challenged them with the idea of, hey, in the next 7 years, their whole world is going to change. And listen, if we can do that on our own, we are mistaken. That we have to make sure that we claim the power of who God is, who Jesus is in our lives. And so here we see this Holy Spirit introduced. Now, there are, and it can be argued, there's 10, some people say 14 different purposes of the Holy Spirit. I'm going to hit the four bigs today, okay? The four big ones, the purpose of the Holy Spirit. Here's the first one. The Holy Spirit teaches and reminds. Here's what it says in John 14, 26. The Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, there's the engagement of the Father again, he will teach you all things and bring to remembrance all that I have said to you. Now, I know that for me, it has been kind of staggering through the years as I've been chatting with somebody about who God is, and they'll ask a question or something's going on in their lives, and it's like the Lord will just put a scripture verse right into my head that I wasn't even considering. But the Lord brings that scripture verse right back to me, and I suspect there's a bunch of you in here who could testify to the same thing, where that scripture verse came back, and that scripture verse was exactly what that person needed. And here, that's what this is talking about. It teaches you and gives you remembrance. In preparation for today, I was reading one book, and it was a book by a guy named Howard Rutledge. And Howard Rutledge was a pretty famous pilot, and he was flying in the Vietnam War, and he was shot down and was taken as a prisoner of war. And for 7 years, he actually lived in literally a rat-infested pit with 11 other pilots. And they lived in this awful existence. He went in at like 186 or 192 pounds, I think is the exact weight. And when he came out, he was 86 or 87 pounds at the end of the 7 years when he was released, skin and bones. So he lived this very difficult existence with these other pilots. But what I loved is this one quote from him. He said that he wanted to know about the part of him that would not die. And what he was saying with this is he said, hey, we live with filth. There was no restroom facilities. The pit that they lived in was their restroom. So you can imagine how that smelled, right? They lived in these wretched conditions where they fully thought that they would die. And so he said, hey, I wanted to know about this part of me that would not die. And what he discovered was that as a young man, hey, he had accepted Christ as his Savior. Although he had strayed from him, he had accepted him. So he claimed that power. And the Holy Spirit intervened while he sat in that pit for 7 years. The Holy Spirit intervened, and he says that he and the other guys in this pit, they would share memory verses. Now, they weren't permitted to talk, so they'd have to speak when the guards were not watching them, when they weren't watching them. But they would remember memory verses, and he said they were shocked to see how many memory verses they could still remember from when they were little kids. And so they would share these memory verses, and then each of those guys would then memorize that verse as well. They started recounting different songs that they had sung. And so that as soon as the guards would disappear, they would sing these songs with each other. And unlike a lot of other prisoner of war set, these guys, all of these men, all 12 of them, this guy, Mr. Rutledge, plus the 11 pilots who were with him, all of these men survived this internment. They were able to live this super successful life where they understood that God was there. The Holy Spirit intervened for him on their behalf and allowed them to remember things that spoke deep into their spirit. and provided them this teaching, provided them this reminder. Here's the second thing, that it provides conviction of sin. And it says this in John chapter 16, verses 7 and 8. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth, it is to your advantage that I go away. For if I do not go away, the Helper will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. And when he comes, he will convict the world concerning sin and righteousness and judgment. And I love in this section of Scripture how it does emphasize this idea that the Holy Spirit, yes, it teaches and it reminds, but the Holy Spirit also convicts, okay? Now, this is one that I will guarantee you that every person in this room can testify to, okay? I'll bet you every single person in this room could point to a period in time when you were doing something that you knew you shouldn't be doing, or you were going to engage in something that you knew that you shouldn't be engaged in, and you felt this conviction in your heart and in your mind that say, hey, I should not be doing that, okay? So here's the surprise. Every single one of your teachers have had that same feeling. The dude who's standing up front had that same feeling, okay? None of us are immune from sin. And so as we've jumped in, and we know we're not supposed to be doing it, and yet you have this still small voice in your mind and in your heart that says, hey, this isn't what I'm made for. I'm made for something different. I'm made for something better. And so the challenge there is this idea of how will we respond to that conviction, right? And ultimately, the Holy Spirit is there to convict our hearts so that we'll know, hey, that's not the way that I'm supposed to walk. That's not the place that I'm supposed to go. And so I've heard it said in poems, I've heard it said in songs, that there's a God-sized hole in all of us that only God can fill. And while I know that sounds a little cliche, I do know, though, that we were designed for something bigger and better. We were designed for a perfect plan that God has for us. Okay, so the Holy Spirit teaches and reminds us. The Holy Spirit convicts us of sin. Now, here's also, the Holy Spirit is a source of wisdom and power. So in 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and verses 10 and 11, it says this. These are the things God has revealed to us by his Spirit. The Spirit searches all things, even the deep things of God. For who knows a person's thoughts except for their own spirit within them? In the same way, no one knows the thoughts of God except the Spirit of God. Now, what I love about this is that we see this idea that, one, we receive wisdom from the Holy Spirit. That the Holy Spirit is searching and knowing things that are most important, even the deepest aspects of who God is. But then also it's this idea, too, that the Holy Spirit steps in and provides power. The Holy Spirit steps in and provides the skills necessary for you to endure, for you to succeed, for you to thrive. The Holy Spirit is right there. It is a power that, I got to say, so many Christians even don't call upon the power of the Lord. And because of that, they end up living very mediocre lives. God did not design you for mediocrity. God designed you for excellence. He designed you for this perfect, beautiful plan that he's orchestrated for you. And sometimes, listen, we just need to be smart enough to know that we're not smart enough. Get out of the way and let God have sway over who we're supposed to be, right? And so this idea, now here's the fourth thing, and this one is really important to me. So we see that the Holy Spirit teaches and reminds. We see that the Holy Spirit convicts. We see that the Holy Spirit provides wisdom and power. And then also the Holy Spirit provides help for us in our weakness. So this section of Scripture is super, super important to me. But Romans chapter 8, verses 26 and 27, it says this. In the same way, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. We do not know what we ought to pray for, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us through wordless groans, or one translation says, through groanings that words cannot express. And I like that phrase. And he who searches our hearts knows the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for God's people in accordance with the will of God. And listen, what I love is that right when we're dealing with hardship, right when we're dealing with trouble, right when we're dealing with agony, the Lord is right there. The Holy Spirit is right there in the middle of your scene. So let me just say, I have two kids. I've got Alyssa and I have Colton. And Alyssa and her husband are driving up today after work. They're going to leave work around 5 and drive up here. It's about a 6-hour drive. They'll be here around midnight tonight. Can't wait to see my baby girl. She's doing awesome. She's a nurse in Orlando. Her husband is a pastor and doing his seminary degree. Alyssa is a nurse there, right? And so, which makes sense with what she's gone through. But Alyssa, man, if there was something to happen to Alyssa when she was a kid, like she exploded her elbow one time. But this one time when she was three, almost four, I was a guest speaker at a church, and I was at this church, and I was just ready to go up on stage. My wife Karen had taken our daughter Alyssa downstairs to the basement of this church, and she needed to use the restroom. And the restroom door had one of those automatic closers on it, so the door wouldn't stay open, right? So you open the door, and it closes on its own. And so Alyssa, they had used the restroom. She's a little three-year-old kid, and she's walking out of the restroom. And just as she's walking out, the door was closing, and she's a little kid. And she just decided, I'm going to stick my hand in that door. So she stuck her hand right in the door. Now, I'm going to gross you out just for 1 second, okay? It actually cut off her ring finger. So it actually sliced her finger right off the door. Crazy. Let me tell you the end of the story so you don't stay grossed out. They sewed it back on, okay? So that's the end of the story. But let me tell you this. So here's my daughter. She sticks her hand in this thing. She is screaming bloody murder. My wife is freaking out. I'm literally walking up. They're just introducing me, and I'm walking up to step onto stage at this church. And three guys come running up to me. Two of them were close friends. Said, JT, hey, you're not going on stage. Your daughter's downstairs. She's been injured. Hey, what happened? We're trying to whisper, like not making a big thing. At this point in time, they're like, and James Taylor. And no James Taylor's coming up because he's whispering. Nobody knows what's going on. And so I'm chatting with these guys of like, your daughter cut her finger. I was like, she's pretty tough, you know. Like, she'll probably be okay. No, she cut off her finger. I'm like, okay, that changes things. All right, so now we've got to go. Now I hear sirens and the ambulance comes. When she's injured, or either one of my kids, when they're like a little bit injured and they want to just be loved on, they go to their mom. When they're seriously injured and they think like the world's going to end, they want their dad. And so Alyssa, you know, is freaking out, and they've put ice on her, the ambulance there, the people are working on her. They've got her finger, you know, kind of held in place. They've got it iced. They've got it wrapped real tight, and she's got it up like this, whatever that does. And so she's on my lap. We rush out to the ambulance. They strap us both in. She's strapped in on top of me. Whoosh, full sirens, go into the hospital. We go to the hospital. We get to the hospital, and people are like, you know, milling around, but not taking things too terribly serious. And what I found out was that on the report that the ambulance driver had written was, he said, you know, three-year-old girl with a cut finger. And so they weren't taking us seriously. For an hour and 15 minutes, like, we're literally trying to get seen, and I'm like, hey, when are we going back in? Sir, there's a lot of people in front of you, all this stuff. So after an hour and 15 minutes, I had had enough. And when I'm angry, I don't actually get angry. Like, I get really quiet. And so my kids know if I'm going to actually raise my voice to them, they know I'm not really angry. If I'm angry, I'm quiet. And so I went quiet, and I just walked behind the counter where all the doctors or nurses were, and I had a notepad and a piece of paper, and I was just looking at everybody's name tags and writing their names down. And a doctor came out and said, sir, you can't be behind here. I said, listen, I'm just telling you, I would love to see you try to move me. By the way, what's your name? And I wrote down his name, and they said, what are you doing? I said, I'm going to need to know everyone who I'm going to sue when you guys haven't taken serious. My daughter doesn't have a cut finger. It's cut off. And as soon as the doctor said, it's actually severed, I said, it's severed. Like, no one will take us seriously. Man, they jumped into action, and I got to say, at that point in time, I loved it. They actually flew a vascular surgeon who was on a ski vacation with their family. They actually popped that guy on a private jet and flew him back just to do her operation, which was nuts. So they're doing this operation. We finally get them in. It's been an hour and 15 minutes, all this stuff. I'm holding it together. My wife's there. Like 75 people from the church are there in the waiting area. It is chaos over this whole thing, right? I finally get, like, she's in. She goes in with the doctors. They do their thing. It's now been way too long. They've diagnosed it. And I go out to my pickup truck, and I grab my Bible, and I come back into the Bible, into one of this back hallway where all the people weren't. And I go back in there, and I sit on this bed, on this gurney, and I just confess to you, man, listen, I bawled like a baby. I mean, I just did. And I am a messy crier. I'm like a blubber crier, you know, so I'm like, bloop, 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 you know, I'm sitting on this gurney and just crying out to God. Like, I just don't even know what to do. My little girl's back there. The doctor has said, listen, we want to tell you right now, We're not sure we can save the finger. So she might, you know, and I'm thinking it's a little girl, it's her ring finger. You know, someday she's going to get married, and they always take pictures of the ring finger. I mean, I don't even know why that stuff was going through my head, but that's what's going through my head. And I'm thinking, oh, my goodness, you know. They said, hey, if we get it sewn back on, she won't have any movement for sure in that finger, and she'll never, ever be able to grow a nail. So you just need to prepare yourself for that. So I'm sitting back on this gurney, blubbering like a baby on this thing, and I open my Bible to Romans chapter 8. This is the section of Scripture that God brings to me just at that moment. Let me read this scripture again, okay? Because this, now interpret it from the eyes of a dad. In the same way, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. We do not know what we ought to pray for. And at that point in time, listen, I was so emotional, I couldn't even pray. I couldn't even get words out. We don't even know what we're supposed to pray for. But the Spirit himself intercedes for us through wordless groans. And he who searches our hearts knows the mind of the Spirit. The Spirit intercedes for God's people in accordance with the will of God. What a cool promise that is. So here I am sitting on the gurney. I don't even know what to pray for. And here I know that the Holy Spirit is interceding for me with groanings that cannot even be expressed in words. Like, man, does that mean something? You know, I've been, because I also function as a pastor, I've been in a lot of hospital rooms with a lot of people who are in bad shape. And, you know, I've had people come in, and sometimes people want to come in and say things like, you know, it's all to God's glory. And like, and I always just, I'm like, so, I get so frustrated with people who want, here's what I just go in and I just put my arm around and hug them. If they want to cry, cry. Like, I don't have any words to say. You know, the Holy Spirit's with us, and we're just gonna sit, we're just gonna commiserate together, trust the Lord and who he is, you know. But I just feel like, man, words don't need, that's the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit's right there in that hospital room. Now, I know in a group of this size, I guarantee that there are people in this very room going through tragedy. I know of a few situations, and I've been praying for you. I know that there are people in this room going through hardship, going through difficult family situations. A few of you are going through some serious health situations with your parents. And listen, right in the middle of that, right in the middle of that chaos, right in the middle of that fear, right in the middle of that worry, right in the middle of that unknown, is the Holy Spirit interceding for you with groanings that cannot be expressed with words. Right in the middle of it. Hey, that's the power of the Holy Spirit. That's one of the parts of the Holy Spirit that we can claim as his children. That's the power. Let me hit a couple of other things. So here we're understanding the power of the Holy Spirit and what the Holy Spirit does. Now, we talked about this last week, and so I'm not going to hit this too much, but here's where Jesus gives us a command, right? He says, you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. And when he had said these things, as they were looking on, he was lifted up, that's the ascension, and a cloud took him out of sight. Now, we talked about this last week, or 2 weeks ago, so I'm not going to focus on it a whole lot, but I do just want to focus on this one piece, that when he says, stay there in Jerusalem, that's like your hometown, right? So whatever town you live in, that's where you're comfortable, that's where you are, you're meant to be a witness there, okay? But here he also says Judea, which is a little bit further out. We might want to say the county that we live in. It's still our own culture. We still feel completely okay with it, right? But it's a different culture. We go to Samaria. Hey, Samaria is still a similar culture, but it feels different. I love to travel, and so I've had the privilege of going to a lot of places in the world. When I've been to China a couple of times, China feels super different. The language is totally different. The food is totally different. The culture is totally different. It's just a totally different culture. But when we've been to England, England doesn't feel that different. It feels kind of similar. They just have a funky accent, but everybody looks kind of the same, and it feels like America, but it's just, you know, with a great accent. So it's a nearby culture. But then Jesus also says this. He says, hey, and I want you to go to the ends of the earth, the places where you're not comfortable. Now, here's the cool thing, right, is that you guys are here for a brief moment. You know, and then you're going to be moving out to other places too in a short period of time. I mean, you're all high school kids here. In a short period of time, you're going to be choosing your own colleges. You're going to be choosing your own careers. You're going to be choosing what life's going to look like. Some of you are going to stay in this area, probably a pretty good chunk of you. But some of you are going to live in foreign countries, and some of you are going to do different things and have wild jobs where you're going to do super neat things. Hey, are you going to take Christ there? Are you going to take Christ into wherever you're being called and be a witness? Here's the great thing, man. When Jesus lays out this plan that was from his Father, when he lays out this plan, he says, hey, dude, you're plan A, and there is no plan B. You're plan A. You're the plan I have for this world. You're it. I'm it. We're the plan for this world. And so here he challenges them. And so we see this idea of mission control. And then we also see the big 12. And really, it's really 120. So it says, now they, about 120 people, returned to Jerusalem. They went to the upper room and were with one accord devoted themselves to prayer, together with the women and Mary and the mother of Jesus and his brothers. Now, what I like about this, and we pointed this out last time, is how important it is to emphasize what this room looked like, okay? So here's 120 people. We talked about this a couple weeks ago in here where we said, hey, when we look at this room, first of all, there's men and there's women in this room, okay? That we see that Jesus is tearing down these kind of gender divides. In this room, we also have black, we have white, we have brown. We have people from every different shade of skin that we can think of. The world right now says that we're supposed to be divided by those things, gender and the color of our skin and where we're from. The world says now that we're supposed to be divided. And listen, that's not Jesus' plan. He says here's 120 people in this upper room. They are plan A. They are the ones who God has chosen to change the world. And it's men and it's women and it's people from every color under the sun. It's people from all different, at least 18 nations. Some people will tell you as many as 26 nations were represented in that room. So here we have this whole idea. And yet it says there that they're in one accord. So they're united. They're united in what matters. They're united in who Jesus Christ is and who Jesus Christ should be. That they're united in that idea. And so I want to encourage you that you're going to be united as well. If we choose to be united and we say, hey, all of the barriers that we might have, we say, no, listen, those barriers don't exist if we're going to say that we're united with one accord. If we say that we're going to be united in who Christ is. So I actually put this picture in. Whoever's near the lights, you mind just hitting the lights here for 1 second? Yeah, the lights back, everybody walks back there. Does anybody know where those are? Okay, thank you. So look at this room. So this is actually what they think is the upper room, okay? So look at this room. Like, sometimes we think that it's this little teeny space, but you can actually go to Jerusalem. You can actually go into where they really feel like the 120 went after Jesus' ascension, right? So they say this is the upper room. I used this picture. I've got lots of pictures with it being empty, but I took this picture because there's about 120 people in there. So this probably looks pretty similar to what this experience was. You can flick the lights back on. Thank you. So this probably looks pretty similar to that idea, that they're in this upper room. Now here's what I think about. As they're in this upper room, 2 weeks ago we talked about those 12 disciples. Imagine Nathaniel, or he's often called Bartholomew. I'll bet you as he was in Armenia, where he formed a church, where he started the church in Armenia. Armenia is a mountainous nation. It's between 3,300 and 6,000 feet above sea level. So it's high. So it's this mountainous region. As he was in the mountains preaching the good news of Jesus Christ, I wonder if he remembered this time when they were there all in one accord, where he was having to preach and learn a new language and share God's word. I think about Matthew, who was this hated tax collector. And yet Matthew went to the Horn of Africa, to the Simeon Mountains, where he preached the good news of Jesus Christ. I wonder if he thought about this upper room. I think about Thomas, who's this fearful dude, right, known as Doubting Thomas. Tough to be known in the history books as Doubting Thomas. But Doubting Thomas is there. Hey, I wonder if he thought about that as he was on the shores of the Ganges River, starting the church in India, preaching the good news of Jesus Christ there. I think about Simon the Zealot, who was nuts. He was crazy. He was a berserk dude who went down so many different rabbit holes, and then he committed his life to Christ. Hey, I wonder about Simon the Zealot as he went home to the west coast of Africa and he preached the good news of Jesus Christ. Did they remember that idea? Did they remember this idea that the Holy Spirit had empowered them? So listen, here's the challenge, you guys, right? Hey, this year and every year, this book of Acts is the beginning. It's the beginning of the story of the church. You were in high school. Most of you, many of you, are coming to the first place where you no longer have vicarious faith. And this is what I mean by that. A lot of times I'll speak to kids, I'll say, hey, tell me your faith story. They'll say, well, my mom and dad are saved, my grandparents are saved, like my great-grandparents are saved. So, okay, totally cool story, not the story I asked for. Tell me your faith story. And listen, all of you in high school, you're at this stage where you're saying, hey, this story is no longer just the story of my mom and dad. Glad that you have that story. That's wonderful. It's not your story. What's your faith story? Will you choose to let your faith sink deep inside of you and impact you? Will you let your faith change your Jerusalem, your Judea, your Samaria, your ends of the earth? Will you let them do it? Will you be bold? Let's pray. Father God, thank you, Lord, so much for who you are. We thank you, Father, we're at a great school like this where we get to proclaim the gospel. I thank you, Father, so much for this worship team up here today. Man, they killed it. They were so bold and just worshiping you. Let our hearts be infected by that. Let our hearts be impacted by the power of your Holy Spirit. Lord, we thank you that you preach truth to us, that you speak truth into a world that is in desperate need of truth. Let us be your ambassadors. Let us be your witnesses, as it says here in chapter 1. In Jesus' name, amen. Thanks, guys. You are dismissed. If you got any directions, they can go anywhere. Okay, hasta. See you guys.